We also want to strengthen our strategies that assure a rigorous selection and appointment process to recruit outstanding department chairs. And one of the things that came out in the task force is that, you know, in some cases, the role and scope of responsibilities of department chairs are not clearly delineated. And in fact, the appointment for a department chair can sometimes be a short 3-year appointment, which is pretty tough to really understand what the department's doing, tough to take advantage of opportunities, tough to make tough choices, again, in your focus of advancing excellence. And I think there's an opportunity here to really strengthen, you know, how we select our department chairs or other leadership. And as Senator Zaffirini has always stated, and always remember casting a wide net to make sure that we're also being sensitive to diversity of our leadership. In research, boy, what potential the University of Texas system has with 9 outstanding academic campuses and 6 health science centers. We will have 3 emphasis points here: promoting strategic research collaborations, augmenting technology transfer, commercialization of Regent Dannenbaum, and supporting our emerging research universities. So there is an incredible amount of synergy that can happen among our campuses in regards to collaboration, but also between academic and health institutions, but also with other entities within the state and within our nation. You know, we heard yesterday this board affirm a new Ph.D. degree program on clinical translational science. And that is utilizing the power system by bringing 3 campuses together to be able to award a degree. So bringing the best of UTSA, of UT Austin, and the Health Science Center San Antonio in working together to develop a joint degree. And Senator, I know that's been very important to you. We want to identify new revenue streams, including philanthropy, to support research missions. All of us who are engaged in science, you know, at the highest levels, understand that our NIH budget and other revenue streams are flattening, if not declining. And so it's so important for us to be able to convey our message and our successes better, and we need to foster greater philanthropy across the state and our nation. We have a shared responsibility. We can't put the full burden on the state. We can't put the full burden on the student. We can't put the full burden on the university. Our community and our regions and our supporters need to also do their part. We want to augment technology transfer and commercialization. I'm extremely proud of this board for making a standing committee on tech transfer commercialization. It's in its infancy right now, but it's already morphing in a beautiful way. Yesterday we heard a great discussion on, you know, how can we bring industry leaders more into the academic environment to better advise us? How can we actually develop a fund that can incentivize bringing, you know, the incredible discoveries that our faculty make to the benefit of society by bringing it to the market? And so this board today will recommend a Horizon Fund for that, not only to address proof of concept, but also address proof of relevance and also to protect our equity interests. And so I think there's great potential over here as well. And then, of course, you know, we want to support our emerging research universities. And we will be asking each of these campuses to develop business plans to operationalize the strategic plan required by House Bill 51. But I will also say that House Bill 51 also incentivizes excellence in research and centers of excellence across all our campuses. So that bill is actually focused beyond just our emerging research universities. The fourth focus will be on implementing additional cost containment strategies. Again, 4 emphasis points here: standardized system-wide operational systems, implement additional shared service initiatives, conduct administrative organizational reviews, and review and implement effective space utilization. So under system-wide operational systems, I will ask Executive Vice Chancellor Scott Kelly to work with the business officers across the system to prioritize a list of system-wide operational systems to be standardized and then create a longer-term strategy for standardizing those systems. Over the past 2 years, many of our campuses have gone on PeopleSoft and a common HR financial system. So it's not beyond our reach that, in fact, you know, we can actually develop a common payroll. or other common backdoor office initiatives that can save millions of dollars for our campuses. Again, I don't have all the answers right now, but isn't this worth focusing on? We want to also continue to define and implement shared service initiatives to system administration for the benefit of our campuses. Again, what can we do to save a dollar on the campus? About 5 years ago, I remember being at a system council meeting for the health institutions. And Dr. Schein was talking about shared services and about how, you know, what is the potential of actually utilizing the purchasing power of UT system to get the best pricing on reagents and other scientific equipment for our laboratories. Well, I remember we were all a little uncomfortable about that, and gee, that's, I don't know, that's gonna be hard. And what do you mean, we're gonna give that to MD Anderson? And I don't know. Well, you know, Ken got out his hammer. You know, you will move forward in this direction. Well, you know, we've saved millions of dollars, and you know, over the next 5 years, we're going to have to be purchasing a tremendous amount of funds for imaging equipment. Just imagine we can utilize the purchasing power of system to save, you know, to again contain costs. Again, this is not compromising on quality. It's just doing things in a smarter, better way such that we can adapt to these challenging economic environments. And I think there's great potential here for our academic campuses. That's the power of a system. Well, if it's good for the goose, it's good for the gander. If we're going to be reviewing our colleges on a periodic basis, I think it's important to also externally review our administrative structures on a periodic basis. I did this 2 years ago at UT System, and it was a very powerful tool for me to be able to better streamline UT System administration. And so again, periodic external reviews will be important to help us be as efficient and as effective as possible. We also want to review and implement effective space utilization. We need to develop criteria to better assess and improve academic, research, and administrative space, including productivity indices, and review our space utilization policies. I don't think we could be building new buildings unless we're currently utilizing our space effectively, or unless, you know, a building is completely outdated and unsafe. I'll use an example. This kind of hit me right head on about a year and a half ago when I was at a meeting between trustees and presidents. And one trustee stated, you know, I'm very interested in increasing enrollment in my university. And a hand came up very quickly and said, well, if we do that, we need more classrooms. And the trustee basically asked, well, prove it to me, because if you can, we have to modify our business plans, but we'll do so. Well, 3 months later, the president comes in and goes, We can manage without more academic space if we utilize our classrooms, you know, more effectively. So again, it's important for us to really look within. Information technology and the cyber infrastructure of our campuses is going to be exceedingly important over the next decade. This Board of Regents, this past decade, really basically embarked upon the competitiveness initiative, which is a major allocation of funds towards academic and research space to enhance our STEM fields. But I will submit to you that over the next decade, what's going to be more important than bricks and mortar will be, do we have the adequate computing resources to achieve our mission in education and to do state-of-the-art research to make sure that we do not fall behind. When I visit our campuses, and I think my visit at MD Anderson, John, about a year and a half ago, you told me that, you know, in order to reach the full potential of developing targeted therapies, we need to have the computational power to better understand the millions and millions of data out there such that we can better simulate drugs and better determine which drugs will impact to the greatest degree a patient. We can't do this without computational power, and we'll be in trouble if we don't stay ahead of this. And later on today, Chairman, part of the framework is to do an RFP to help us determine what is the best strategy for the next 5 years, and we will need some funds for that. So I hope that you can affirm that in your motion. So I've already spoken about this. We also have to prioritize a dashboard. This is, again, out of the Productivity and Excellence Dashboard, or out of our task force. We determined that the University of Texas system needs to develop a dashboard that can really provide us very interactive data that's both consistent and reliable to help us determine, are we meeting our goals? What are the trends across the important outputs that we want to make? And then, even more important than that, is how can we use this data to prognosticate about how to make better decisions into the future to address the changing environments that we're faced with. So it's important to have data, but we also have to use this as a diagnostic tool to better predict our future. And so, again, out of the Productivity and Excellence Task Force and bringing together our presidents, we came up with what a dashboard might look like, although it'll be far more comprehensive than this. But it'll determine what we're going to be following as a system, not only what we're doing this current year, but over time, such that you can also assess progress over time or lack of progress. We'll take a look at the institutions at a more in-depth level, and then also at our colleges at a more in-depth level. So anybody could get into this interactive dashboard, and it'll help our regents, it'll help our presidents, it'll help system make better decisions. Now, I will also submit to you that this is an evolving dashboard, and we've been through a very rigorous time period of a lot of requests for data. And I think we're getting to a new steady state. But I'll also say, you know, there are going to be more requests when appropriate to be able to make sure that this dashboard ends up becoming a national model, but for the use of making better decisions. And I think that's very important for a system the size of the University of Texas system. Well, again, if you speak to Ron DeSafity, or if you speak to any president, we understand we can't get from good to great without philanthropic support. And when you take a look at the University of Texas system, 70% of all our philanthropy comes from three campuses: UT Austin, MD Anderson, Southwestern. That's not to say that our other campuses aren't doing well, but it is to say that we have an opportunity to get better. And so one of the emphasis points in this framework is to develop and implement a multi-year business plan demonstrating a balanced and effective development program with appropriate targets and goals tied to institutional strategic plans. It is vital that we do better in philanthropy and that it makes up a more consistent revenue stream, a more predictable revenue stream, such that we can lower the cost per degree for our students and we can achieve greater success in our research missions. I'm very excited that the board is interested in renewing the Strength in Numbers initiative to make strategic investments in key development personnel and operations to increase private revenue, including support to system provide to individual institutions high-quality professional development officers where needed. You know, my development office at Health Science Center in San Antonio when I got there was broken. Well, it wasn't broken, but we weren't achieving the goals that we wanted. I came from Harvard, I came from Yale, and the development officer, Dr. DePino, said, we need to start a capital campaign. I go, well, what's a reasonable capital campaign? Well, let's go forth for $300 million. I said, well, that should be easy. You know, billion-dollar campaigns at Harvard and Hopkins, a piece of cake. Every time I'd come up to system administration, Ken Stein would tell me, how are you doing on your capital campaign? I go, not so well. He goes, well, the chancellor's a little concerned about that. I'll never forget that elevator ride to the chancellor's office. Well, I realized then that I needed some help. I called Ron DeSafity, and she gave me some advice. We implemented that advice, and we completed that goal.